honor and respect certainly to our, well, Dr. L.
Yes.
Amen. Brother Holmes. Amen. God bless you, woman of God. And certainly I dare not go any further without just applauding and thanking God for this vessel.
Yes.
Of course. Amen. Certainly God has given her a liberating word for the body of Christ.
Yes.
And we're grateful.
Yes.
Amen. Take your seat while I do a few preliminaries and just bring you greetings from Bermuda. Shekinah Worship Center. I've been telling folks we are not in the Caribbean or Caribbean. People get it mixed up. We are actually in the Atlantic, pretty much 600 miles straight across from North Carolina. We're just out there by ourselves, nobody else. And so we are blessed for God's hand of protection and how he has caused that our forefathers would build our homes in such a way that once we do experience that storm, that we are already, listen to it now, prepared.
Hallelujah.
Well fortified. And I believe that's exactly what God's word is deeming, that we understand that if we partake of it, then we are already, as it were, foundationally prepared for anything that is to come. And so we bless God for that. And so bringing you greetings from Bermuda, the elders of Shekinah Worship Center, and they just say, go ahead, Pastor, go where you gotta go. We'll do what we've got to do. And we've trained a body of preachers and teachers so that we know everything will be well.
Amen.
Amen, amen. Certainly to my husband of 32 years, we thank God for him.
Amen.
He is left in charge of the church.
Amen.
So we'll touch base with him later. And I tell you what, we are grateful to have been chosen for such a time as this.
Yes.
And that's the way I see it. You know, you spoke it in the beginning, in the end.
Yes.
It's already done, so, you know, pretty much God, you take care of your business.
Yes.
You've taken care of it, now I'm going to walk in it.
Yes.
And so this time that I spend with you, it is a pre-prepared word, meaning that God, through the Holy Spirit, has also made us aware and inclined our ear to hear, so that now you would have an ear inclined to hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. Now, just before that, I'm going to say this, and then we're going to grow. We have here the first book, wrote this book in literally 21 days, as my youngest, my 16-year-old, I got a 27, 25, and the 16, as she was 1 year old crawling around my knees, we wrote this book. God poured it into me. I remember in the dream, he said, you've been writing a book. I said, what book? He said, it's in you. I said, okay, so I got up and I wrote it in 21 days. And it really introduces the world of the womb to the world. There are seven wombs in existence. The mind of God created the universe, created the earth, which birthed man, which birthed the woman, which births children. She births children. And then we all have a natural mind. So again, if we can tap into the mind of God concerning all matters, then we know how to handle matters. And that's what's important. So I only brought a few of them. And certainly you can check that out at the end of it. Now let's get to the business at hand. What is the challenging moment, the word, that God desires for this particular time? Let me say again, Dr. Holmes, I don't take you for granted that God birthed in your spirit this very moment. And because of that, I get to walk in a new place that I haven't walked before. I don't take it for granted. God bless you. And in his absence, certainly God bless your pastor, your covering, your husband. Amen. Women of God, are you ready?
Yes.
All right, let's do that. I'm going to pray. We're going to read God's word, then we're going to go into it.
Okay.
Let's do this. Father God in heaven, one more time we approach your throne room in glory. God, thanking you because we're comfortable with you.
Amen.
God, thanking you because it's already done.
Amen.
Now, God, Holy Spirit, we talked about this. Now I'm asking that you'll bring it back to my remembrance.
Yeah.
And then, certainly, as you're inclined to do, when you give me insight, I'll speak it. I will not withhold from your people. So, God, I thank you for this moment that's done. Bless it to us that we can be a blessing in the earth. In Jesus' name we pray, God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. So, what a theme I don't take deans for granted. People who come up with deans, I figured you had some type of group, some study, and you got together, chose something, and so I like to stick with that dean. And here we have pearls of wisdom and power. Pearls of wisdom. Well, let me stop here, a bit of wisdom. I'm thinking of my elder here, Elder Sharon Haywood, who has been uniquely designed to deal with me. And I just say it like that. I just think, you know, you say some people are special. And, okay, we're all unique. And it takes a particular person. She says it's easy. I don't think it's easy. I believe God has graced her for such a time as this. Can we put our hands together? He didn't have to do it, but he did. And so we have pearls of wisdom and power. Now, the first thing I want you to understand in this being is you're saying wisdom and power. So we're just not talking about wisdom, but we're talking about a power based in wisdom. And it's going to take understanding, continuous understanding, comprehension of God's word so that you walk in the fulfillment of both wisdom and power. So I want to speak to you on this topic today. Are your pearls fake or faith? Are your pearls fake or faith? And so we have Matthew 13:45-46. Here beginneth the reading of God's word. It says, "And again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls, who, when he had found," well, what is this, Seaman? "When he had found one pearl of great price, went, sold all that he had, and bought it." Yeah. He bought it. So many of us are seeking so much, a lot of things, but really we only need it. We only need it. I'm going to help you. Listen here, we live in a time where we can surely say, you know, acknowledge that knowledge has increased. In particular, as you look at the area of technology, we can see that there is a hunger and a thirst to improve upon the latest device, and the world is seeking to earn it. The latest device.
Come on
now. Huh? In the last week, we have Apple that has released the latest device.
Yes.
I believe it's iPhone 8.
Yes.
Uh-huh. I'm always interested with how a company such as Apple releases its next upgrade iPhone. They give you a preview.
Come on.
Yes.
They tantalize you with information about what it can do that's greater, bigger, or more proficient than the one before it.
Yeah.
Well, women of God, they do so knowing that the next thing they will tell you, watch this, is the cost. I'm trying to help somebody. That before they tell you the cost, they give you the glowing attributes. Because if they told you the cost first, you might turn the TV off and say, "I ain't ready for that." However, the setup is that I tell you all the good things about it so that you'll buy into it before you gotta go and buy it. Not different than the gospel at all. In that God speaks the goodness of his word. Because he understands that you're going to go through something, but I've already told you what the end shall be. Oh God, what if the women of God, and we've heard it, are focused on the goodness of God, on the wisdom, of course, of God, so that no matter what we have to go through, oh God, you said it, oh God, I believe it, oh God, that settles it. And so, upgrade. Some of you are planning it already. You know, birthday present. Bermudas, you say birthday. Birthday present. Anniversary. Christmas is coming up. Oh, there are plans being made right now. The Apple company has timed, look at this, the release of the iPhone in order to maximize its power. But what if we understood that the word of God was released thousands of years ago? We all have been given a measure of faith. This woman of God has been given the official office of faith. There's a difference. And I'm going to support it in the Word. As I go through this Word, that there is a difference. Right? Now, the Apple School Company, they have an understanding of how the market works. They know their product and they know the public, the consumer. They have used wisdom in capturing unto themselves a ready market of consumers to support them with their purchase. You know, I like the iPhone 6, so I'm going to get the iPhone 7. But I like the iPhone 7, so I'm going to get the iPhone 8. Yeah. What if, God, I like what you did. I approve. God, I see your faithfulness and how you handled the situation before. So I'm going to go for the upgrade. The situation is not the same, but you, God, are the same. Yeah. And since you are the manufacturer of all that has been and all that ever was, I trust you. You have the skill, the know-how. You are omniscient. Yeah. You have all scientific coordination of what needs to go where in order for me to experience the results that I need.
Come on, yeah.
We're going to have to learn to work faith. So, I'm here to tell you that concerning their product, your wisdom must be with understanding. If you're broke, you shouldn't be. I don't care how much that phone works. There are prioritizing aspects to the possibilities of this purchase.
Come on,
and so wisdom and understanding must be coupled together so that you don't go and do the right thing at the wrong time. Huh? The right thing is always the right thing, but it's the timing of the right thing.
Come on, man. Come on.
Hallelujah. And so the Bible clearly tells us that besides wisdom, you want understanding coupled with that. You want the biggest bang, as it were, for your wisdom. So you need understanding. Let's talk about it. Proverbs 3:13-15. Happy is the man that findeth wisdom and the man that getteth understanding. Yeah. Let me pause here. So I was on the plane, you know, I may not be a spirit. I'm with you on that. I was playing a game and the battery ran out. I was like, oh, man. All right, let me open up the Bible read. And so I landed in Proverbs 3:4. Solomon's talking. And Solomon is talking about vanity, all his vanity.
Yeah.
And basically, this is the summation. He says, I could afford everything, I could have everything, and you know what? I afforded everything, and I've had everything, and you know what? Basically, he says this, and I'm still going to die. And it's empty. So can I help somebody here to understand? You have to make sure that what you're trying to afford is the purpose and will of God. Not doing something because you can do it, but understanding that God preordained for you to do it. And so that's what you do. So look at this wisdom understanding. 14, for the merchandise of it is better than the merchandise of silver, and the gain thereof than fine gold. She is more precious than rubies.
Yeah.
And all the things that thou canst desire are not to be compared to her. To her. Why do Bible talks about wisdom and understanding and her? Because the herness, that's a new word, I look it up. The herness says this: if you use wisdom with understanding, there'll be reproduction.
Oh, come on now.
The Bible don't. If you use wisdom with understanding, you have the possibility of bringing forth all that will be, as it were, spiritually fertilized within your spiritual womb so that the earth can be blessed with who you are. You don't want to leave the earth empty. Empty of having fulfilled your purpose. Enter into the grave and say, and people be saying, man, they could have. You must aim to acquire wisdom with understanding. You see, you can speak wise words, help me Jesus, to a fool. And without the understanding, that fool remains a fool.
Come on, yeah. Come on.
However, you can speak those same words of wisdom to a wise person, and their wisdom is increased because
Yes.
You can have a room full of people speak the same word. Some of those people are going to run with the word and their lives are transformed. And some will be at the same place the next year. Why? Nothing wrong with the word. It's where you are and if you're being obedient to having the wisdom with understanding. You see, if you want pearls of wisdom and power, you've got to understand what your pearls are about. Got a lot of fake pearls happening around here. I'm telling you something. I don't mean here. I mean in the church. Everyone can sit under the same message. Some grow, some no. They don't grow, they don't get it. And so via this chapter in the book of St. Matthew, God is teaching you and I that if you ever get the real thing, the real pearl, listen to this, the pearl of great price, the pearl greater than all else, hold on to it, cling to it, don't let it go, then you have found what you ought to have been looking for. The real gospel message, the real message of the kingdom is worth more than anything. I can't raise a hand. I want to, but I won't. We want real, not fake.
Come on.
We want faith, not fake. Yeah. Understand, there are many pearls.
Yeah.
Many pearls. You said it in your thing. Pearls of wisdom.
Yeah.
I can see that in my imagination. Pearls dropping.
Yeah.
All over the place. Pearls of wisdom. Yeah. However, there is only one pearl of great price.
Come on now.
So my challenge to you today, as I go through the word of God, is are you looking for all of the pearls? The pearl drops? Or are you looking for the dropper of the pearls? Are you appreciating the gifts? Or are you valuing the gift giver? Because if you can value the gift giver, you have the gifts all the time. If you can appreciate your God, our God, then there is nothing too hard for God. Oh, yeah. And so understand, we ought to be searching not for the golden nuggets or not for the pearl nuggets, but for the one who has breathed this out. Frankly, we are living at a time when the message of the kingdom of heaven is falling, hear me, is falling amongst dry ground, standing ground, and choking ground. You got to follow the lesson because this is Bible. We're going to show you in a minute. All these pearls are dropping. Okay. This means that although heard, the precious pearl of wisdom of the Word of God is being missed. Today, through the ministry of the Word of God, I hope to encourage you to handle your pearl wisely. Understand that the kingdom has been made to be, it is the potential of your life. When you think like kingdom, I mean, you just dream and you know it's going to happen. Because the dream is really a vision. And my thing is that if God placed the vision, if he placed the vision for you to see up in here, then you just need to keep on going towards the vision. Going towards what you see. Because I'm not great like that. I can't make vision appear in my mind. When I go to sleep, and God speaks audibly in my sleep, when I go to sleep, I am, listen to this, unconscious, dead to the world. Yes. Yet, because God supersedes the world, God breathed out, God, I told you, the universe and the other world, you can be dead, sleep, or you want. The one who made the universe and the earth will speak to you. Woman who came out of man, who came out of earth, who came out of the universe, who came out of the mind of God. And so the key to the success of your life is not knowing a person or a place or a thing, but knowing the one that spoke for the person, the place, or the thing. And that's empowerment. And so permit me, as I do when I'm home, to navigate through 3 points. Point number one, if you're taking notes, point number one, the value of the pearl. The value of the pearl. Point number two, The victimization of the pearl.
Mm.
The victimization of the pearl. And then we're going to bring it home. Number three, the victory of the pearl.
Come on now.
The victory of the pearl. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. So let's deal with the point number one, the value of the pearl. These pearls of wisdom, what's the value? Well, these pearls of wisdom must all be derived from the pearl. That's the key. The pearl of great price. Have you paid a price? Let me read your scripture verse again. Your scripture verse, you provide it to me. Ask me for 12 years.
All right,
man. You provided this to me, teacher of 10 years.
Yeah.
Matthew 13, 45, 46. Again, the kingdom of heaven is likened unto a merchant man seeking goodly pearls. Seeking good, you know, in a vibe, on a good mission, seeking goodly pearls. But what happened? Who, when he had found one pearl, seeking good things. You're not in a bad space. You're not doing a bad thing, but it doesn't mean you're doing the good thing.
All right.
You want to make sure that your good thing is a good thing.
Yes.
So he says, who, when he had found one pearl of great price, went and
what?
Sold all that he had and bought it. We have to have sold out Christians. Oh my God. I grew up in the church in a day. I've been to church all my life. When we heard sold out. Between whatever the cost, you know, I'm a pastor. Yeah, the children are in school, but I know those children are home at 8 o'clock and 9 o'clock on TV. Why can't you be in the house of God? And they don't understand that. That means you haven't sold out.
Yeah.
Watch this. At home, I say, my God, I hope it works. Catch this.
Woo.
That's what you got to do. That when, this is what they are missing. That as a parent, you're training your child. And so when you make your child an excuse when you can't be in the house of God, that's the training the child takes in. And therefore your next generation, your, should I say, pearl drops the standard because you drop the standard in declaring unto them that you ought to be sold out for the kingdom. Come on up in here. So no matter what wisdom you hear, no matter what you hear, this wisdom from who you hear it from, that wisdom must stem from one pearl. See, I'm going to say this, and then I'm going to try to leave America alone after that. I want to sit under preachers that are so in love with God's word, so trusting in God's word, and they actually believe God's word.
Yeah.
That after having preached to you, I don't walk away and forget what I said in the mirror.
All right now. All right.
I'm just going to say this. I don't understand how we have mega churches and mega fallings.
Yes.
What were you preaching? Yes. Did you believe? Okay, I'm going to leave it there. But I'm going to tell you, they have not found the pearl of Christ. Because for the kingdom, you deny your flesh.
Yeah.
For the kingdom.
Yeah.
Oh my God, you sell whatever you've got to sell. The pearl. What is the great pearl? Here it is. The great pearl is the kingdom of heaven. How do you know that the pearl you're hearing is from the kingdom of heaven? You know because the kingdom message is the word of God. You can go back and trace, follow that preacher, that presenter, whomever. They are lined up with the precious word of God.
Yeah.
The pearl is the kingdom. This is it now. In action. In action. When I look at you, I ought to see the kingdom.
Yeah.
When I look at you, I ought to be able to use you as an example of the kingdom at work.
Yes.
The kingdom. church and be tickled by the word.
All right. Right.
Let's borrow drops. We come into gather in order that we're empowered to carry out the Great Commission.
Yes.
Matthew 13, 3 and 4. This is earlier on. You got to check out what's been happening. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds. Some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Listen, understanding that Jesus is sowing the seed. I don't want you to forget this. In the word, prophet Jesus, I can do all things Jesus. He's coming and he's teaching the people. He's sowing seed. He's sowing seed. He's showing us the kingdom. Now, if Jesus, and he is of the kingdom,
come on.
That means that which he serves out of him is the kingdom.
Yes. 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 Hallelujah.
So if he has the kingdom seed,
come on then.
Then as he speaks to the people, he's not sowing watermelons. He's not sowing apples and mangoes. You gotta understand it. This is Jesus. Jesus, the living word. Huh? The kingdom that became flesh. Oh, yes. And so he speaks. And when he plants the kingdom. That's all that he can plant. Is that which he is. He's the living word.
Come on.
And so he plants the word and he forgets it. He doesn't miss it. Jesus never misses it. He plants the word. He's the master teacher.
Yes. Yes.
He teaches the people. He teaches the disciples.
Come on.
He says the kingdom of heaven is like this process. So now listen to Jesus. This is the part that eases me up as a master. Eases me up. Jesus sows the seed, and at the conclusion of this lesson, 25% of the seed succeeds. Some fell on stony ground.
That's right.
Some fell on dry ground.
Yeah.
Some started, but they got choked up.
Oh,
but wait a minute, this is Jesus.
Come on,
nothing wrong with Jesus.
Yeah.
Nothing's ever wrong with the sower. The sower, Jesus, it's the seed receivers.
Come on.
So, see, when I'm coming to church, going to church in the morning in Bermuda, you know, everywhere I look, this is beautiful water, blue, shades of blue and green, just gorgeous, and I'm driving, and I'm thinking to God, God, I'm about to go into your house, God, I'm with your people.
Yeah.
God, do you want to show me something, tell me something I need to say? I'm listening, because I understand that sitting amongst me, who are... Maybe tonight's, today's tonight's day, it's going to be 20, 30%, 60, and 100.
My God.
I don't know. Or is it the 25, 25, 25, 25? And so God, as I speak your word to the people, help the people to have prepared themselves.
Yes.
Because you're the soil.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, catch this. Catch. Get in battle. Good, just like him. Good. And so the question is, here's a big question. All week long, what have you been doing with your soil?
Jeez, come on
now. Have you been allowing the soil to be turned over?
Yeah.
Or are you allowing people to turn you off? Because whereas some people look at the interaction of people and stop it there, no, this interaction And that is ironically nice that we have our teachers. I tell them, come in here talking no hump day. I'm like, you're on your last. Every day is an attitude day. And my question for you is, how do you handle the adversity that comes? It's going to come. But how are you prepared? How will you irrigate the soil during the week? How do you stir it up? My God, you got to stir it up with the word. You got to stir it up with good fellowship. Stir it up with prayer. Stir it up with an attitude that I don't care what comes against me. I am made to worship God. I am a seed receiver. I am a female. I am a male with a womb. Oh, you're not left out, brothers. We are made to receive seed of the word so that the female can reproduce, the male can reproduce, and the kingdom can grow. God is pro-life.
Yeah.
It's always all fertilization and reproducing. And the devil is pro-death. It's all about death and killing and stopping reproduce. Jesus, now I'm talking about Jesus, he then goes to talk to the disciples. They want to know, Jesus, why are you talking parables? Why are you talking parables? Jesus tells them, that the parables are for understanding of the people. The people. Why? Because they actually are being taught daily by the disciples now. They're being taught daily by the sower himself. Now, put a little peeping in it right there. And they still missed it. They still denied it. We're none but John left at the cross. And so sometimes we got to give a break and we got to understand. We sit under the word and we can miss it. They walked with Jesus and they missed it at times. And then Jesus was so inclined that out of the 12, when he had to go experience something deep and he wanted to show you something, he said, okay, Pete, James, John, let's go, Ace boys. You come with me. And when he had to entrust his birth mother, the vassal entrusted to carry him forth and into the world. He only had John. So could it be, I'm just throwing this up, could it be that God allowed all the others to be tested so that only the right one was left there? Only the one that understood their purpose to this end was left. And so I remind you that the seed of the word of God, or the pearl of great price, is his word, you gotta love it. It's so valuable that the devil does not want you to get it. So number two, the victimization of the pearl. He does not want you to get the word. People get sleepy. People get all types of things during the word. Why? Because this natural body, we'll wear on you. And the word, the enemy spirit doesn't want it to germinate within you. So victimization, when I say victimization of the pearl, I mean how the pearl of great price is made out to be something negative. 13 and 14, same chapter. Therefore, speak I to them in parables, because seeing they see not, and hearing they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah, saying, which saith, by hearing, ye shall hear and shall not understand. And seeing, ye shall see and not perceive. God says that even though the sower is there, right there, and the seed is there, they're missing. As I pondered on this, I heard God say, today's church has succumbed to the world. Rather than the world conforming to the church, the church is being conformed to the world. Hence, rather than there being a pearl of great price, watch this. Then he said this, I had to slide to see that. I say, good God Almighty. So let me start that sentence. I'm going to bring it to the term. I want you to hear. Hence, rather than there being the pearl of great price, the church has become a culture curl.
Mm.
A culture curl. A cultured pearl. A pearl after the culture of the world. That's not the pearl of great price. The culture pearl of the world will have the church looking at the wrong image. The image that we must look at is the Bible. This is the image that should shape your life. This is the image. This is your mirror. When you get up to see how you look, it should be through. The mirror we should be looking at is the mirror of the Word of God. God, show me me. Show me who I am. Show me what I am to become. Show me the kingdom. Lord have mercy. When I say that, I feel important. Of course, of course, of course. Show me, you know. Show me the kingdom. See that? Then you don't have no self-esteem.
Amen.
I know all Christians have no self-esteem. The kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
Now, sadly, the mirror that most is used is what came in your kit. I didn't even carry a mirror. Here we go. Two things I didn't carry: a mirror and a watch.
Wow.
Had it for probably 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Because God taught me as a teenager. You know, being a teenager. Can I give a little story?
Yes.
Oh, Lord, here comes a little story. I met my husband at 15 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And he's the only man I've ever known, ever been with. But what happens is, teenagers, we are silly. So he can come to church and it'd be about my boyfriend.
Yeah.
And God began to teach me. He said, what I've called you to, you need to focus only on the Word. So don't come to church looking for Him. You got to sit by Him. So that was the Sunday that He moved me from about the fifth row at the end and said, go right up the front and sit down.
Come on.
15, 16 years old, being groomed, didn't know why, didn't know how, but understood that God said, I want all of your attention.
Yeah.
I want everything about you.
Yeah.
I want to groom you in a way that when people look at you, they'll sense the kingdom.
Uh-huh.
They'll sense eternity.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yet in the world, it is what it is, and we got to talk about it. It's this mirror, man. Hey, what I'm looking like. Nobody can make it up to a boy. God, what are you saying?
Mm-hmm.
You got to make sure every strand of hair is in place.
Mm-hmm.
I tell my folks, look at me right at the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
Because after that, it's going to be done. That's it. That's it. No, not a little story. They like little stories.
Mm-hmm.
You know, decided to go natural. Because the mix was something, and I finished preaching. Hair is all over the place. Well, you just start all over the place. Just start all over the place. Huh? Yeah. So listen to this, I'm connected. So I made the big chop 3 years ago. I made the big chop in the natural, but I've been made it in the spirit.
All right. Yes.
All right. All right.
If this doesn't add to my life, if it doesn't add to the kingdom that God is already proclaiming concerning my life, let me tell you something. You know, we take, give me the cell phone. It's the mirror. There's one, I would not like a picture taken in the bathroom. Got a mirror in the bathroom. Now you can take out your secondary mirror and everybody can see you in the bathroom taking a picture. It makes no sense to my scientific mind. I taught science for 20 years, so it's like, there's something wrong with that picture. Why do I want to see bathroom stall doors behind? Because they are so caught up in their self, they don't know what's all right. important that you be particular about who you procreate with.
Mm.
It's because of the power of the sperm, the seed.
Mm.
Because it's able to bring forth much fruit. And so therefore, depending on who you join with, it's going to indicate what that seed harvest is going to look like. And so we've got to understand the significance of lining ourselves up with the Word of God. Even people we connect with, if they don't speak your language, that's going to be an issue. All right? I'm not talking outside of evangelism. We got that. There must be an interpretation of the Word, a delivery of the Word in such a way. Yes, you did it, Jesus, didn't you? Yes, in parables with them, specifically to you. And so there is a way to coagulate the Word, or I should say discoagulate, or uncoagulate, or miscoagulate. One of those words, the Word of God, decoagulate. That's my English teacher. She comes in handy. Amen. And so we de, bringing out of, D-E, so that we take the difficulty out of the Word of God, so that those who are untrained can be trained to come in, and then we take them up to another level. And so we've got to, get out of the mirror a little bit more.
Come on.
We take more time. You see, she's like, fix your pearls, Pastor. Fix your pearls. Fine now. We have to spend less time. And I'm not saying, trust you me. I'm not saying we ought not look the best that we can look. But there ought never be a competition between how much time I spend in the Word and how much time I spend in front of the mirror. You know, I'm telling you, I had three girls. I understand. I tell my mama, another story, I'm a teenager. You know why this woman had to say this? Because she knows I'm built a certain way. So I'm about 13, you know, just hitting the teen years. And, you know, I had halfway decent looks, so I was fixing my hair, my things, I had a bun, pushing my hair back, a nice bun, every strand of hair intact. So she comes moseying along and says to me, words I never shall forget, vanity is vanity, Lord have mercy. Since then, that's when I stopped about the mirror, was my mother said, that's vanity. And so really what she was saying, because she knows how I'm made, Maria, don't focus on your looks above what I know the kingdom has deposited in you. I'm a bit older so I can see a little bit more. Don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. And so, you know, is it about my red makeup, hair on fleek, shoes on point, everything suppressing? Look like a hallelujah over there, you see that? But listen, when you're more caught up with the mirror, this mirror right here, you know, and now, look at this. Back in the day, it was just a mirror.
That's right.
Now you got magnified mirrors. But look at it. The enemy always wants you to magnify yourself.
Yes.
Always, you know, I know we're going to use it for a particular reason, but we've got to understand the spirit behind it. Is that you become self-focused.
Yes.
Me, I want to know, watch this. How do I look in the eyes, in the sight of God? Is my heart pure? Are my hands clean? Is my prayers pleasing to you, God? God, are you happy with my prayers? This culture, the culture pearl of this world, will have you tired of holiness preaching. That's not necessary. No, we don't need that. We can't go far left or far right, but holiness is right.
Yes.
Holiness is on the right, I'm going to tell you that. And so listen to this. I'm taking you through this chapter before I wind it down here, 15 and 16. For this people's heart is what? It's waxed gross. That's a common artery. What should be traveling through their system with ease has now been clogged up with the cholesterol of this world. And high cholesterol, it's not like the cholesterol says, I'm going to kill you. It just gathers. What's your company?
Lord Jesus.
They won't send out a message, I'm going to kill you. But if they're clogging up, your praise, your worship. If they don't know the word, that's cholesterol. Their ears are dull of hearing, wax. And their eyes have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear. They want you to be doing with your eyes seeing. And hear with their ears and should understand. Here it is, wisdom with understanding. Understand with their heart and should be converted, and I should heal them. So in other words, the word of God is telling us, for the purpose, we shut down their eyes, we stop up their ears. I want to hear that. That's where we've gotten today. I don't hear the name Jesus. It don't take all that. Dull, clogged. And you know, when God created this body, this body obeyed God. He made the eyes and the ears with a purpose. So the devil comes to steal your purpose. So that you can't hear a thing. You can't see a thing. And it's being spoken right in front of you. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Jesus said, disciples. You know, the disciples were a crew. A motley crew, some call. We expected all the disciples to be deep, but you got to remember that they were fishermen.
Yeah, that's right.
Smelly, rough fishermen that go up water into the kingdom. What does this say? It's not about your vocation. It's about your destination.
Come on now.
It's not about where you come from.
Yes.
It's about where you're going.
Yes.
When the church becomes worldly, you can sow all the seed you desire. And this is what happens. It'll just hit dead space. The most precious pearl, the pearl of great price, the kingdom message of salvation, falls on infertile ground and is lost to those persons. This is the victimization of the pearl. As beautiful and precious as this word is, why doesn't everybody take it and run? Why doesn't everybody grab onto the kingdom? And it's because their ears have been stopped. Stuffed. Eyes shut down, blinded. You can say how much you love God all you want. You can give them every testimony. But if they are deaf and blind, they're not in the place to appreciate what you've been through.
Yes.
They're going to get there, though. They will get there.
Yes.
If it be God's will, then it shall be. And so listen, this is one thing I had to learn. Stop casting your pearls before swine.
Yes.
Lord have mercy. The pig ain't going to appreciate your pearls.
Amen.
You know, you can have the most clean pearls, real pearls. That pig is a pig. It's not going to say, wow, they've cast real pearls before me. I'm going to mess that up. Oop, I'm not going to get any mud on that. The nature of the beast is that it destroys or muddies or tarnishes whatever's placed in front of it. And so the same is for the beast that's in there, the devil. That whatever goodness you place before him, his natural inclination is to take it and turn it to the negative. That's why it's important that when you have experiences in marriage or relationship, you don't cater to the beast in you. But we caught. And sometimes we feel like we should. But if you want to ever experience the beauty over the beast, then you have to begin to listen and see the God at the end of it all.
Yes.
No excuses. Just do it.
Amen.
I love when people tell me you can't. I don't even respond to them. They said, the deaf, dumb, and stupid. What I will simply do is do it. And they will see it.
Yes.
Don't say a thing. They will see the manifestation of it. And so that way I'm not casting. I'm confessing. I'm walking in it to bring about the God conclusion. I'm I'm talking about appreciating the pearl of great price so that you can then experience all of the pearl drops.
Yes.
And so this brings me to point number three.
Yes.
The victory,
yes,
of the pearl. The victory of the pearl. All right. 45 and 46 again. Here we go. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like unto a merchantman seeking goodly pearls. Who, when he found the one pearl of great price, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Be glad, women of God. Be glad if you have not been distracted by the world.
Yes.
That in the world we live in, you still desire God.
Wow.
You still desire holiness.
Yes.
You still want to gather together. You have not become couch potato Christians,
yes,
where you get everything via the internet. There's something about getting yourself,
yes,
up,
yes,
and getting yourself ready, prepared as a vessel to enter in.
Yes.
Now, you ought to rejoice about that. Be glad that the preached word of God gets a hold of your heart and you water it.
Yes.
You know how many, picture it, you know how many unkept gardens are in the house of God?
Jesus.
Village grown over the place.
No.
Permitted weeds of self decisions. Have no tools to manicure. I mean, really, we go back to Genesis. Wasn't that the job description of Adam? I created everything for you, Adam. Now just take care of it.
Yes.
Made sure that there was a workplace before you placed the man there. I don't know how women, I don't know how they end up with a man who don't work.
Yeah.
Right there, out of the will of God.
Yeah.
I tell my people, you need to bring them to see me. First of all, if I don't know them, that's an issue right there. Second of all, here you know John 3:16, and there's a Genesis and a Revelation, we're going to have an issue. Don't settle. This is your garden.
Yes.
Okay, I heard this by the Holy Ghost. Catch. Okay, watch this now. God has given each of you, this is responsibility, your particular place in the garden of the original Eden to manicure.
Mm.
Now, we know about manicure because we get your fingers done, your nails done, we get your toes done, so that everything looks on point. How about if we took that same attitude into the house of God and made sure that our word was on point, our praise was on point, our worship was on point?
Mm.
That's when you're not allowing the culture to influence you.
Yeah.
But you've taken on the original kingdom.
Yes.
And that absolutely becomes your methodology of life.
Nice.
That if God, if you don't approve of this, it won't be done.
Mm-hmm.
All right? So listen. You've got the victory because you've gotten a hold of the pearl of great price. And when you have this pearl, you will sell the world to keep it. God, if I have to give up this and that, see, that's it right there. What is it? God, and I would tell people, sex. Look, anything on earth is a downgrade from heaven. Oh, boy. Today I'm going to explain to you.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to try to help you out before I go back home to read. People, I've had it, will say, oh, I met this guy, and they will give up the church for the guy.
Oh, my God.
And usually, the guy is not there 2 years later, and so she's missed out on the guy and the church.
All right.
Now, this is what, no marriage in heaven. No sex in heaven.
Right.
No sex. I know. I'm going. I know you're gonna go soon. I know you love you some. Your Dr. Mike. He ain't gonna be your heaven. He ain't gonna be your husband in heaven. And you'll be like, come on home. Make me none of that. Because that is an like my husband's gonna be mine in heaven. God's gonna have to take away my memory because I'll be a jealous woman in heaven. Jesus, it's going to be good. It will not be good. Oh, Lord, I remember this man since I'm 15. An orgasm?
Oh, you
don't know. I better not. Come. I'm a science teacher. What we think is an orgasm has nothing on the glory of God.
Come on.
See, and what the devil does, he gets you caught up, but it feels good. I'm telling you, if you ever experience God in his fullness, if he does something for you, phraseology. It's not about your position. about your disposition.
Ooh.
You're great if you have the kingdom within you. You're great if you understand where you've been called to. You have the power. One girl. One girl. How it manifests itself? Well, I'm a teacher. I'm a preacher. I taught science for 20 years, biologist pre-med. And so I know how to demonstrate. You may be a singer. You may be a business person. Those are the manifestations of the great pearl, the pearl of great price. How you deliver the kingdom. But the pearl is the kingdom. And so if anyone speak aught to you, but the kingdom, you have to deny them. Because what must resonate in you and through you, the precious building blocks of the word of God. And I'm going to wind it down here because I think we have to go full circle now. We've tried the world. We've done some things. Now, mind you, some things of old. I grew up in old Pentecost. I didn't get my ears pierced. I was 35. Right? We grew up, we didn't go to the movies. That back in the day, y'all. You know, we didn't believe, you see, I and them go to me, and I'll tell you why. We didn't believe in kissing. Right? I remember one time I did, though, and I had a lead service the next day. I had to go before going. I wasn't going in front of the holy pulpit. And if, watch how I say that. I let him kiss me. I didn't initiate. It was all his fault. You're a liar to this day. I'm telling you the truth. But I was so like, oh my God. That standard, Maria. One being can send a crush. How can I go up there and lead God's people? That this is now 17, 18, leading praise and worship. How can I go and deliver myself as a vassal of honor when I know I dishonor the standard I've been told? Can we get some standards back in the kingdom?
Yes.
Can we do that? And watch this now. It's not about your dress, but it is about how you will address your dress. Holiness is not about what you wear. But it will influence what you wear. And so the dominant culture of the land will cause you to water down your pearl. So tell somebody, it's my pearl.
It's my pearl.
That's right. It's the word of God that has been delivered unto you. This most precious faith. I won't let it go for anything. And now we must teach our children.
Yes.
Train our seed. So that the fertile ground is manifest in their lives. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Amen. Put your hands together for the word.